For TrojanInsider.com, my name is Pete Ghersen, alongside Scott Schrader here at the Memorial Coliseum. And ladies and gentlemen, what was that? USC falls 15-14 on homecoming against a Cal Berkeley team that hasn't beaten USC since the Aaron Rodgers days back in 2003. Scott, it was 14-0 at the half. USC's defense was firing on all cylinders. The offense was looking good. And then all of a sudden, everything changed after that bad snap and a safety in the second half, and it went all downhill from there.
It all went downhill, kind of, I think. You know, USC had a chance to go up 21-0. You know, and Amon-Ra unfortunately fumbled the football. But that is stuff, every time we do this show, we talk about there's stuff like that that happens. USC finds ways to lose football games. They get off to a good start. They have a chance to take a commanding 21-0 lead, even if it was 17-0. They get the ball to start the second half. I mean, you could win the football game right there. And they don't. And next thing you know, it's 14-9, and then they lose the football game. But, you know, they lost to Cal for the first time since 2003. But that was a good Cal team, and that was a good USC team. These are two really bad football teams that played today. You know, Cal left feeling good because they're bowl eligible.
Yeah, they were getting their helmets and bowling them at the end, right in front of the USC fans right here.
Right.
We're kind of in the Cal student section or fan section right here, and they really let everyone know that they were extremely excited about this win. And I mean, why not be when you haven't beat a team in over a decade?
Next year, USC can do that with the helmets because they'll be maybe bowl eligible next year because they aren't now.
Yeah, 5-5 now for USC, and of course they got one more road game at UCLA in a week. And then right back here against Notre Dame, a team that I don't see USC beating by any stretch of the imagination. But, Scott, are they even going to be able to beat UCLA? I mean, UCLA beat Cal 37-7 just a few weeks ago, and that was up in Berkeley.
So I'm inclined, you know, to say it's going to be a challenge because USC doesn't play as good on the road.
Right.
UCLA, you know, depending on what day it is, can put points on the board. They have a quarterback that can run. You know, USC secondary is decimated.
They've got a good coach, some would say.
Well, you know, I mean, he's won big football games, and he's had championship-level football teams. So, yes, he has proven that he's qualified to be a head coach of a big-time football program. And so I'm inclined right now, my gut feeling tells me they're not going to win that football game.
At UCLA.
They're going to lose that and then get annihilated by Notre Dame and not be bowl eligible for the first time since God knows when.
Since Paul Hackett. Remember him?
Before I ever saw a USC football game, before you were probably covering.
The good news is that Paul Hackett led to Pete Carroll, so there's hope maybe. He might be available again. I don't know.
Clay Helton was, you know, the post-game press conference was somber, you could say. Yeah. It was Tyler Vaughn's. You can check it out. We have it up on our YouTube channel, but Tyler Vaughns and Cam Smith are kind of just sitting there shocked, and Clay was just, he backs his players up. He takes the blame. He got to hand it to him, but man, oh man, that first half, I thought some of the play calls were great. The 4th and 6, that they picked up 7 yards with Amon-Ra St. Brown, great call. The next play was a 23-yard touchdown to Tyler Vaughns played terrific. He had 2 touchdowns. He made some unbelievable catches. No Michael Pittman tonight, who's arguably USC's best receiver, and he stepped right into that role and played well. But I thought that end of the first half drive where USC went in front of 4th down, converted it, got the touchdown on a beautiful thrown ball by JT Daniels.
Yeah.
And then you mentioned Amon-Ra fumbled the ball, which really could have kept the momentum going into the half.
Even if you score 3 points right there,
exactly.
You are up 3 scores. Well, USC wins the football game, essentially, is what I'm trying to say.
17-15.
Correct. So
another 3 points I want to talk about is very early in the game. USC looked like they're going to kick a 42-yarder with Michael Brown. And instead, Clay Helton pulls out a little trickery, or maybe it was Baxter, special teams coach, that pulls it out. And they go for a toss to Michael Brown, who's not the most fleet of foot, I would say. Not the fastest guy on this USC roster to throw a ball to.
Kicker.
Yeah, of course. And so he got tracked down. The play never got close to converting the first down. And I was calling the game on student radio up in the just above the press box here. And I sit on air. I was like, those 3 points might come back to bite USC. I mean, it's too early to tell here in the first quarter, but sometimes when you don't kick a field goal, that may be a sure thing. And I saw Michael Brown pregame kicking 50-yarders on the field, and he looked good.
Make those.
And so I was like, against a good defense, this Cal defense came in, they had allowed 36 points in their last 3 games, 12 points per game, against good opponents too. They just barely lost to Washington State. They beat Washington.
So good defense. There's just no denying that part.
Yeah.
So this was going to be a challenge, you know, for the USC offense, because USC's offense is nowhere near what Washington State's is, and Washington State was lucky to score 19 points.
Yeah.
So, but it's all there's just so many little things that USC is doing wrong and not executing. Play call. I don't even want to talk about play calling anymore. I don't even want to talk about that because it's so much.
I do.
But it's so much.
There's so many decisions that happen in the game.
But
that
I hear you.
Of course, hindsight is 20/20. Hindsight is 20/20, and you wish you could have it back. But that field goal, I think they should have kicked. Some of the timeouts that Clay called late in that second half that totally burned them. One play, the USC comes out for a fresh set of downs. First play, they throw a 50-yard bomb to Tyler Vaughn's double coverage. And that's kind of JT's fault. He's throwing into double coverage. He likes to do that. And now it's 2nd and 10, and USC doesn't have a second play. They call a timeout and burn a timeout because they have no play to run on 2nd and 10.
Okay, so what is the common denominator when we talk about all these little things that happen every week? It's always something or a bunch of things that at some point, it's just so crystal clear that you need to change the person who is in charge. And I don't mean Lynn Swann, but maybe I don't know what his deal is. We don't really know anything about Lynn Swann. But you're at the point right now where you need to change a head coach at USC. You can't put Band-Aids on this thing forever. Neil Callaway gets fired. T. Martin is now the receivers coach. It's so much bigger than that, the issues at USC. We can talk about play calling. I did this last week. I think I went down the line, right? We can talk about play calling and the running game and this. But USC goes every football game an entire half with like 42 yards of offense.
Yeah, they did in the second half tonight.
Right. So this is so much bigger than play calling and blocking and all this. It's because all the little things. Details. Yeah. When all these little details are being neglected, you end up with a big, giant piece of poo.
And all these details add up. You're right. It's not. You can't blame one play, one thing. But there's just some stuff that you're just questioning.
This is the
some
Rams
simple
play here tomorrow, so they're gonna wipe all that filth and muck off that football.
They're power washing the logo and the hash marks right now.
But we have to move the tripod.
Twist it around. Another big play that, of course, I know Scott. We don't want to harp on him too much. Biggie Marshall's had a fantastic senior season, his best season as a Trojan. And he's had a good sophomore and junior campaign. And he's rated as Pro Football Focus has him rated as one of the best corners. Almost no one's thrown at him. He has like averages 5 targets a game. Quarterbacks aren't even thrown at him.
Right.
He has no picks, but that's in part because no one's thrown at him.
Right.
But tonight, it wasn't Biggie's best night. He played pretty solid defense. He was also out there on a very injured ankle, Clay Helton said. He was just fighting out there for his teammates. But he was getting a little chippy and jawing a lot to the Cal sideline. It was clear as day. He was lined up on the right in front of the Cal sideline on many plays, on many series. And finally, he said too much. A referee heard him. And it was going to be a 4th down for Cal on a play on that pass to the near sideline where the Cal receiver just had his foot out of bounds. It was going to be 4th down. Cal was going to punt.
Let me stop you there.
And they charge a 15-yard penalty.
How in the world did they call that? How in the world could two referees call that in bounds? Anyway, that's my rant.
Clear as
I cut you off.
Clear as day that the guy was out of bounds. They did overturn the call, and it was going to be 4th down. But after the play, Biggie was jawing to the Cal bench and got flagged for a 15-yard penalty. That's an automatic 1st down. It gave Cal a fresh set of downs, and honestly, that kind of ended the game in my book.
It was of course, because that was the end, and USC was going to get the ball back, on a punt. But good Lord. We all watched that football game. There was no guarantee USC was going to gain a yard if they got the ball back. So that play was big. Of course it stands out. I mean, it's crucial. And USC makes a lot of those crucial penalties like that, those personal foul kind, that irritate fans, I think, more than any.
Yeah.
But that was not why USC lost this football game. But, yes, we have to talk about it because it was a huge, huge, huge play. So was Toa's snap over JT Daniels. Oh. Somebody said Michael Jordan couldn't have got that ball.
Or maybe Shaq or someone. Yeah.
And Toa, I mean, we love Toa. So this is we're not harping on Toa. This is, it was a bad snap. And that's not why USC lost also. USC lost because they scored 14 points.
That was a huge momentum shifter, though.
I know.
Toa's safety, it gave Cal great field position at the 50-yard line. They went right down.
And then they scored a touchdown right away because of the field position.
Elijah Griffin committed a pass interference, then he got burned on the touchdown, and he was jawing.
Was that pass interference, by the way? I couldn't see.
He never turned his head around. I thought it might have been, yeah. But he was getting beaten up, and that was his last series out there after allowing that touchdown. But Toa's snap, and Clay said Toa is the best center that this USC team has. He's,
well, let's blame which, Ross St. Brown because he fumbled. No, I mean, we can't keep doing this. But
Scott, isn't it interesting that Clay says he's the best center that USC has, and the guy week in, week out is still failing to give out clean snaps? I mean, isn't that a tough thing for a Division I program, a Power 5 team like USC, to say he's our best center and every game he's good for a bad snap?
Toa, you know, I talked to Toa's dad, and we were talking about it, and, you know, it's Toa's dad was thinking that USC would have been better served if they moved him to tackle.
That's his natural position.
After the Texas game. Right? So here's, you know, Toa's dad was talking about it, but, you know, Clay made a promise to Toa, and, you know, through thick and thin, you know, he's going to ride with it no matter what.
Yeah.
So that's where we're at. You know, Clay's an honorable man and a loyal person, and to a fault.
Yeah, sometimes. I mean, the players love him. The coaching staff, I think, all appreciates his hard work and his, you know, genuine.
To a fault as a football coach, not as a man.
You're right. Yeah, he's a genuine guy. He's very straightforward. He's very straightforward with the players. But as you mentioned, sometimes something's wrong at the top, and sometimes a change is needed. I'm going to go out there and say that I think Clay Helton is going to be gone at the end of the year. I think he'll stay for the final two games because I see no point in making a change for 14 days of a football team, especially when you take into account the fact that the players do love him. But I think this loss may have solidified one of his final games here at the Coliseum.
Yeah, I don't know what to say. You know, they're telling recruits that he's coming back. You know, can you pull off the Brian Kelly, what they did at Notre Dame, where you just got all new assistants, new coordinators, but Notre Dame spends money. You know, USC, just they don't spend money anymore on coaches. Ed Orgeron pays Dave Aranda $2.5 million, I think, to coordinate his defense. I mean, Clay's entire staff doesn't make that. Maybe they probably do, but you know what I'm saying. USC has not gone all in with spending money since Pete Carroll because they will never let a coach or a staff become that powerful again. USC wants to be known as an academic institution and not a football factory. And, you know, there might be a point where fans are just going to have to adjust the way Stanford fans have been happy with just having a football team that wins six games. I don't know.
So the offense, we're missing some key players tonight. Steven Carr is out with a high ankle sprain. Michael Pittman was out. Chuma, who was listed as a starter, didn't even dress, which was surprising to a lot of us. And the USC offense still looked very solid in that first half. JT Daniels was 15 of 20, 75%.
It was really good.
The run game, this Cal defense had allowed 95 yards or less on the ground four times this season. And they allowed Washington State a season low on the ground, somewhere in the 80s.
So you get teased. This is, you know, you see a USC, Josh Ann, our guy Josh. Shout out to Josh. He said, you know, USC's a first quarter team. And you don't ever want to be labeled if you're a first quarter team, but that's what they are.
Remember at Texas when we were there and they looked great in that first quarter, and then before you know it,
so they're really
out of hand.
Finding ways to lose football games. That's, you know, every week, I mean, you know, Cal won this football game, but geez Louise, it was just as much as USC losing it as it was Cal winning it. So, you know, Cal should be excited. It was a great game. Congratulations.
And they're bowl eligible and USC isn't, but USC's offense, even with those guys, they look great in that first half. They were up 14-0. It should have been more. They were going to get the ball back to start. They did get the ball back to start the second half, but it all went downhill from there. USC had 90 yards on the ground in the first half. In the second half, and they picked up eight net yards. They averaged 2.6 yards on the ground. So this Cal defense, I guess you could say, is for real. Vavai also went out with an ankle injury late in the game, so it was down to Sed Ware, and I saw Marquis Stepp get up off the bench, off the sidelines.
Marquis Stepp rides his bike every game. I mean, he's just waiting to go in. He's just waiting to go in. He's waiting to go knock over defenders, and he never gets put in. And I'm sure there's a plan for him. We don't know what it is. But, you know, all of a sudden, Elijah Vera Tucker is starting, and you've got –
who you think's the best lineman, right?
And, yeah, Jalen McKenzie's in there. I don't know what kind of game he had, but when it's not working, try something else. And, you know, Marquis Stepp, good Lord, he can play four games, right?
Yeah, I don't think he's
– and redshirt?
I don't think he has played.
He's had two carries, I think.
So he can still redshirt with another game under his belt.
Let's see what he can do. You need one more win to be bowl eligible. I suppose win that game, get bowl eligible, then play all your freshmen.
Tell me about Elijah Vera Tucker. I don't know much about the guy. You say he's one of USC's best linemen, if not the best. Tell me why you say that.
Yeah, you just look at a guy who can stand his ground. And he looks like he's fundamentally as sound as any of the guys. He looks tough. He's not – you can't label him with that soft label that a lot of West Coast guys get.
Yep.
He just looks competent. And I guess that maybe that's what it takes to look the best at USC right now, just competent. Now, this is not disrespecting, because I think USC has an exceptionally talented offensive line. These guys are all going to be really good at some point. So if they get the coaching thing figured out, stop the hemorrhaging. So these guys know what they're doing. I think they already feel better about where they're going with Drevno taking over. Not that that's going to save the program, but it's a step in the right direction. So,
yeah, it was tough. I mean, USC outgained Cal on offense. They had more first downs. They led in the position in the time of possession battle, and they just still couldn't come away with it. That safety ended up playing a huge part, and I think, honestly, that field goal that – Clay tried to go for the fake on fourth down, really bit the Trojans in the behind. But, hey, as we mentioned, you can't keep saying one play. It's the collection of all the plays, the collection of the play calling, the collection of players making sometimes boneheaded mistakes like what Biggie does. And Biggie was – Clay Helton said he was sick to his stomach, you know. The guy obviously didn't want to do that, but sometimes your emotions just get the best of you out there in a big game, a homecoming game, and, you know, stuff happens.
Okay, so we established that Tyler Vaughn's had a good day. But the defense gave up, you know, there's a safety. So, you know, they gave up a couple touchdowns, right?
Yeah.
So the defense played pretty well.
Yep.
They gave up 200 total yards to Cal. I'm on the field. I don't see things like you guys do. Talk about some guys that stood out to you today on defense. We need to talk about positive stuff.
Yeah, we'll talk about the positive.
Pelotu stood out to me. I don't know. Maybe it was just me.
Well, he had the lone sack, so that would stand out.
There you go.
I was looking at the stats. Porter Gustin is still leading USC, of course, in the sack department. He's still in the top two or three in the Pac-12 in the sack department with his 7 on the air. And it'd be nice to have him out there. It'd be nice to have Talanoa out there. I thought Cam Smith kind of played his best game since coming back from injury.
Yeah.
Actually, on one play, he missed a tackle, and he came up a little bit gimpy, and I was kind of like, that's on the normal Cam Smith I'm used to seeing.
Right.
And I'm like, is he a step off because of his injury still kind of nagging him, his hamstring? He came right back the next play, tackled the guy in the backfield for a 5-yard blast.
That was a big tackle.
Yeah. And so I was like, nope, that's the Cam Smith that I'm used to seeing. So I think Cam played great.
The secondary did fine, too,
Isaiah Lanley and Ajani Harris had a pretty solid game. Lanley was barking. He even barked. I don't know if you guys were watching on TV. They were showing it plenty on the ESPN cameras. He was barking on the sidelines with JT and I think said where after the safety, and I think it was kind of like, hey man, we just shut out Cal for an entire half, you guys go right back out there in the third quarter and commit a safety, what's with that?
Yeah. Now I'm looking at messages. I'm getting messages from
Scott's getting his recruiting info right here.
From recruit's parents wondering
it's only 12:45 at night here in LA. But
I don't know what's going on. Sorry.
But, yeah, the secondary, for the most part, I would say, other than Elijah Griffin, who got burned a couple times on the pass interference and on the deep touchdown, for the most part played well. Yeah. But the defensive –
Cal is bad offensively at the same time.
It is, yeah. They had 90 yards to the air, and their quarterback is a redshirt freshman who doesn't look like he's, you know, the best passer in the world. But the guy can run, and he had – I called it. I was calling the game on the radio. I knew that they were going to run on that – fourth down? It was third and 7, and they did the same play that Manny Wilkins at Arizona State did. They ran a quarterback bootleg. Yeah. They ran it around the corner. Marvell Tell stopped him just short, but then they sealed it on a quick run up the middle and put the game away with their running back on the fourth down, and USC had burned their timeouts and couldn't do anything else. But, yeah, Tui Pelotu, as you mentioned, played well. Jenny had a couple good plays. USC forced a turnover, for the first time in a while. They almost had a couple others where the receiver's knee was just down and they reviewed it, and it was the right call. The Pac-12 refs got it right for this time.
You know, but it's been nice watching football games without, you know, 18 penalties, though.
Yeah.
So this was obviously, you know, it's been much improved in that regard.
It was a quicker game than normal. It's just,
you know, they're
really
a football team that's, you know, they're so close to playing really good. And
so close from like being 7-3. Right?
So when things aren't working, you just got to figure out how to change them up. That's all USC's at right now. They are so close to being like next year with some key changes with the approach to coaching. And if it's coaching changes, this football team can be really good right away. So, you know, and now it's just a matter of waiting to see, you know, if they can finish the players on the team right now. They just want to finish. They want to focus on beating UCLA and Notre Dame,
especially the seniors.
Right.
Cam Smith and these guys just want to go out strong.
Finish off the season, like you said, strong, positive, build towards next year.
Yeah. So UCLA next weekend, that's a must win for the Trojans. They'll be favored in that one, but who knows what's going to happen with this 2018 USC team. And then Notre Dame.
UCLA and the points.
Notre Dame to end the year. It's going to be tough against a very talented team. Brandon Wimbush, yeah. That whole squad will be here at the Coliseum Saturday after Thanksgiving. It could be a massacre. We don't know.
It might be ugly.
But, Scott, let's say USC beats UCLA next weekend. Let's say they lose to Notre Dame. That doesn't really matter if they get crushed or not. They'll be bowl eligible at 6-6. What bowl would USC go to?
I don't even know.
Holiday?
What's the worst bowl?
Sun Bowl. You always text me. You're like, we're going to the Sun Bowl. We're going to the Holiday Bowl. We're going to the Poinsettia Bowl.
The only thing positive about the Sun Bowl is I'm that much closer to San Antonio for the Army All-America Bowl game, which it's not even called that anymore.
Two birds with one stone.
Yeah, see? So I'd rather have them play in whatever the bowl is, the Valero.
Alamo?
Yeah.
Alamo Bowl, yeah.
That's the one I want.
I want to be on the West Coast. I don't have to spend my college loans and buy another plane ticket somewhere.
We're going to Santa Clara, so we got that going for us.
That was a fun trip last year, too, especially with a nice, successful victory. All right, so.
All right, so that's a wrap. We got to go. It's bedtime.
Sorry.
It's almost 1 o'clock, but we appreciate you guys tuning in. Check out TrojanInsider.com for more analysis. We got tons of video interviews from the post game. Definitely a tough one for the guys to swallow, but they'll still talk about it. They're still Trojans. We'll still bring you the content. We'll be back at practice this week giving you guys more. So for Scott Schrader, my name is Peter Ghersen. We'll say good night, and thanks for tuning in.